All right, I guess everyone, this enormous crowd, welcome to the CME for the December Red History Lecture. I'm Daniel Bensaïd. But there's some housekeeping stuff to just take care of before we get to that. It's not an overly long talk. First of all, I'm Doug Green. I'm one of the volunteers here at the CME, which is out there Monday through Wednesday, roughly 4 to 8. You can check the Facebook page for actual hours. If you notice the pin I'm wearing, this has nothing to actually do with this talk, and it's with politics that Daniel Bensaïd would not like, but I filmed an event last night with Aaron Leonard, who wrote a new book on the Revolutionary Communist Party and FBI infiltration. Also a small crowd, but there's video of it if you check the Facebook page where I post my stuff on Red History Lectures. It's not enough crowd for you to care about the trash, but take your trash with you. This actually is kind of fun. I don't think I've ever got to announce this before. Is obviously I lecture here, I volunteer here, and I'm also the author of Spectres of Communism, which is on Louis Auguste Blanqui, and you can pre-order the book on Amazon. So Spectres of Communism, Doug Green, if you want to do that. And lastly, for housekeeping, next month is Ordega, the Italian left communist. Definitely fits the bill for this series, which is the obscure, the neglected, the people we just don't talk about all that much. And in my case, I actually don't particularly, not a big fan of Ordega, but let's give the man his due, and we will do that next month. And I have to be careful, since a lot of my historical interests coincide with French left history, Bensaïd falls under that. And, he's an interesting comrade, and I guess we can get started with the Resolute subject, which is dedicated to my brother Daniel, who probably has actually never read Bensaïd, but that's okay. But anyway, following the collapse of the Soviet Union and the Eastern Bloc, it has been fashionable to say that the time for communist politics has passed. One commentator went so far as to claim that history had ended, which meant capitalism was the only game in town. For many leftists, politics shifted from Marxist theory, strategy, fighting to win, and they instead gave up on an alternative vision, and their politics were reduced to begging the ruling class for realistic reforms. Yet there remained a stubborn few who refused to accept that capitalism was the sole vision on the horizon, but maintained a stubborn fidelity to Marxism and revolution. One of these was the French Trotskyist Daniel Bensaïd, a key figure in the Revolutionary Communist League in France, or the LCR, a leading participant in the May 1968 general strike, and a militant Marxist intellectual. Bensaïd practiced a critical and creative Marxism throughout his life that fruitfully engaged with other radical political thinkers such as Blanqui and Benjamin, and he refused to believe that the last word on our future had been said. Rather, he argued that resistance to capitalism was not only possible, but he gave serious thought about what it would take to win. Thus, Bensaïd remains a powerful voice to argue for strategic thinking and developing a resolute subject that would overcome the crushing weight of the objective situation. Bensaïd's political activism extended back to the early 1960s with his youth involvement in the French Communist Party. However, Bensaïd, like many of his generation, was repulsed by the party's dogmatism, conservatism, and lack of initiative during the Algerian War of Independence. By contrast, Bensaïd was attracted to the revolutionary ideas of Che Guevara and Trotsky, along with the growing opposition movement to the Vietnam War. And Bensaïd and other dissidents were expelled from the Communist Party in 1966. And during the events of May 1968, when 10 million workers and students launched a general strike that brought French capitalism to the brink of ruin, Bensaïd was one of the most prominent leaders of the March 22nd movement. The Communist Party had done everything to pull back the May movement, so Bensaïd and his comrades began forming a new organization that they believed could provide the necessary political leadership for a future revolution. this organization was the Young Communist Revolutionaries, or JCR, using its French initials, which was banned by the French government after the May strike, and was later reformed as the Revolutionary Communist League, that by the mid-1970s was one of the largest Gauchist or leftist groups with 5,000 members. For Daniel Bensaïd, the days of May 1968 and after were, in his words, a time of hasty Leninism, when it was the duty of each person was to contribute his or her little strength as best they could to settle this alternative between socialism and barbarism. It was in part up to them, therefore, whether the human species sank into a twilight future or blossomed into a society of abundance. This vision of history charged our frail shoulders with a crushing responsibility. In the face of this implacable logic, impoverished emotional life or professional ambition did not weigh very heavy. Each became personally responsible for the fate of humanity. It was easy for Bensaïd and his comrades to believe that revolution was coming, as the struggles from Vietnam to Latin America to Europe demonstrated, with worker strikes, armed guerrillas taking up the gun, and students hungry for radical ideas. However, the hopes of these revolutionary ideas were not crowned with victory, but instead met with defeat, catastrophe, and for some, anyway, disillusionment, as neoliberalism reigned triumphant across the world. Yet Bensaïd maintained a perspective for strategic thinking over the long haul, the need to be resolute, and to seize upon unexpected revolutionary openings. In short, Bensaïd was a dialectical voluntarist who not only sustained his fidelity to revolution, but thought seriously and sincerely about how to win. It was a worldview that could be found throughout his work, and in our day, not very popular when history was to have ended. But Bensaïd was determined to brush against the grain of history. Now, by dialectical voluntarism, what was what the radical philosopher Peter Hallward would call the will of the people, which is a deliberate, emancipatory, and inclusive process of collective self-determination. Like any kind of will, its exercise is voluntary and autonomous, a matter of practical freedom. Like any form of collective action, it involves assembly and organization. For Bensaïd, the subject to carry out collective revolutionary action was the working class. Yet Bensaïd's view of the working class was not the crude class reductionist workerism of the French Communist Party, which saw only exploitation existing at the point of production. For Bensaïd, this view of the class struggle was a crippled and deformed Marxism that left the CP's Marxism a stale theory which produced a reformist practice that did not challenge the system. Rather, he argued that Marxism was not a reductive, normative, or classificatory definition of classes, but a dynamic conception of their structural antagonism at the point of production, at the level of production, circulation, and reproduction of capital. Classes are never defined only at the level of the production process, the face-off between workers and employers, but determined by the reproduction of the whole when the struggle for wages, the division of labor, relations with the state apparatus, and the world market enter into play. This was a dynamic view of how the working class is shaped and reshaped by these social contradictions and the continued development of capitalism. And if to Bensaïd there were retreats as well as advances, then the vulgar Marxist idea that the continued march of capitalism, which brings forth an ever more united and concentrated working class, needed to be dismissed. Rather, the deep divisions of the proletariat would not be overcome on their own. But according to Bensaïd, the unity of the exploited classes is not a natural given, but something that is fought for and built. And to do this required the conscious creation of a collective political will. And the conscious intervention of by a political will, according to Bensaïd, was needed because capitalism would not disappear on its own. Without being stopped, capitalism was liable to destroy the planet, whether through war or ecocide. This meant history's outcome was still undecided. In his view, Marxism must banish a determinist or teleological philosophy of history. This left Bensaïd skeptical of the whole idea of progress. While Bensaïd acknowledged the rapid advances of industry and science of modern society, he linked this with the environmental crises that threatened the survival of the planet. Bensaïd upheld the Jewish Marxist intellectual Walter Benjamin, who we'll speak on in February, dialectical view of progress that was outlined in his 1940 theses on the philosophy of history. According to Benjamin, progress was a storm threatening the future, the so-called progress and enlightenment of modern society was built upon immense suffering and exploitation that occurred throughout history. And he said there has never been a document of culture which is not simultaneously one of barbarism, and just as it is itself not free from barbarism, neither is it free from the process of transmission in which it falls from one set of hands into another. And one look at Bensaïd's home country of France makes this clear. Modern France grew wealthy from the enslavement of Haiti with its rich sugarcane, which was harvested by slaves. And the glorious revolution slogan of the 1789 revolution, Liberté, Equality, Fraternity, was championed by French colonialists and soldiers who ravaged Algeria, among other places, for 100 years. And it was not the task of a Marxist to perpetuate this storm of progress, but to break the cycle. Now, closely connected to Bensaïd's rejection of progress and determination was his determinism, was his defense, along with Benjamin, of Louis-Auguste Blanqui's voluntarism. Blanqui, who lived in the 19th century, was the consummate professional revolutionary and man of action. He's one of the loudest and most uncompromising voices in the 19th century. France calling for class war and the violent overthrow of capitalism. And he meant it. From 1830 through 1870, he organized secret societies and participated in at least five revolutions to bring about the advent of communism. The only method of action, however, open to Blanqui was an elite and tight-knit conspiracy which would strike capital at the appointed time to bring about communism. Each time he failed, and he paid the price by spending more than three decades in prison. His eagerness to rush into revolutionary battle caused him to act before the time was right. While Bensaïd was aware of the great weaknesses of Blanqui's voluntarism, he highlighted one of its strengths. It nevertheless saved him from the straitjacket of scientific determinism. Blanqui, like Benjamin and Bensaïd, remained skeptical of philosophies of progress and determinism, highlighting their costs. History is sketched out with broad strokes in the most beautiful cold blood and with piles of corpses and ruins. No butchery can raise an eyebrow on these emotionless faces. The massacre of a people, evolution of humanity, the invasion of the barbarians, intrusion of young and new blood in the old veins of the Roman Empire. As for the populations and the cities that the cataclysm flattened on its path, necessity, inevitable march of progress. Yet if socialism is not guaranteed by the onward march of historical progress, what then justifies it? Drawing on Blanqui's insights, Bensaïd argues that capitalism is to be opposed because it is unjust and exploitive, and that the ethical dimension of socialism as a struggle against injustice is also crucial in Blanqui's eyes. For Blanqui, according to Benjamin, was not motivated by progress, but with a determination to do away with present injustice, the firm resolve to snatch humanity at the last moment from the catastrophe looming at every turn. Thus, if the danger of societal destruction was revealed, it was up to revolutionaries to force a decision by creating a collective will to overthrow the old order. So how was this rupture to be achieved? For Bensaïd, this answer revealed itself with a crisis. However, by crisis, Benjamin based himself on Lenin, who said, one, when it is impossible for the ruling class to maintain their rule without any change, when there is a crisis in one form or another among the upper classes, a crisis in the policy of the ruling class, leading to a fissure through which the discontent and indignation of the oppressed classes burst forth. For a revolution to take place, it is usually insufficient for the lower classes not to want to live in the old way. It is also necessary that the upper classes should be unable to live in the old way. And two, when the suffering and want of the oppressed classes have grown more acute than usual. And three, when as a consequence of the above causes, there is a considerable increase in the activity of the masses who uncomplainingly allow themselves to be robbed in peacetime, but in turbulent times are drawn both by all circumstances of the crisis and by the upper classes themselves into independent historical action. However, a revolutionary crisis did not automatically generate from cycles in the economy. A revolutionary crisis, Bensaïd argues, is profoundly political. It involves a crisis of the power structure with a political dimension from the very start. Major revolutionary crises have occurred throughout history, the Russian Revolution, the Chinese, the Cuban, and others, for it is in those moments that the seemingly impenetrable power of the ruling class and their state apparatus is weakened and can be toppled. is during a crisis that all the cracks, fault lines, and gaps of society finally become fully revealed in all their ugliness. It acts to lay bare the battle lines which have been obscured by the mystical phantoms of the commodity. And Bensaïd argues that for masses of workers and oppressed who are suddenly awakened to political life, the relationship of forces can be radically altered, creating the possibility of changing the world, or at least changing society. In other words, the impossible suddenly has become possible during a crisis. A crisis gives rise to an exceptional moment, which is perhaps a few hours, a day, a week, 6 months, or maybe longer, when there is an opening for radically different outcomes, socialism or more murderous capitalism. As we've seen, Bensaïd does not argue that there is a predetermined, preordained outcome where revolutionaries are guaranteed to win. The crisis can only be resolved, he says, at the hands of a reaction which will often be murderous, or by the intervention of a resolute subject. The instrument for this resolute subject to arrive at the desired outcome, he says, has to be the vanguard Communist Party. For a left that has washed its hands of Leninist authoritarianism, Bensaïd's advocacy of a revolutionary party may appear quaint at best, or a relapse into totalitarian excesses at worst. Rather, in the hands of a more thoughtful left, such as John Holloway, whom Bensaïd sharply criticized, we should aim to change the world without taking power, perhaps by growing our own garden or changing our lifestyle or what have you. Or, if a little more bold, maybe showing our moral outrage to the powers that be, then after fighting the good fight, we can go home and pat ourselves on the back for having changed nothing in the process. While Bensaïd had a soft spot for libertarian left currents, he understood that anarchism, syndicalism, and any politics that denied a party is bound to lose. If you want to win, you have to develop the means to win. And ultimately, without developing a party, according to Bensaïd, we don't possess politics. As he says, a politics without parties, whatever name, movement, organization, league, party that they are given, ends up in most cases with a politics without politics. Either an aimless tailism toward the spontaneity of social movements, or the worst form of elitist, individualist vanguardism, or finally, a repression of the political in favor of the aesthetic or the ethical. And at the center of Bensaïd's strategy to win was the party. For him, the way to break the grip of the fetishism of commodities was via crisis and the struggle of parties. As he put it, this is indeed the Leninist answer to the unsolved puzzle of Marx. And of course, the party sought the conquest of power and the establishment of revolutionary rule with a republic of councils on the model of the Paris Commune. This meant that revolutionaries could not ignore state power because, in his words, it will not ignore you. You can act superior by refusing to take it, but from Catalonia to Chiapas via Chile, experience shows right up to this very day that it will not hesitate to take you in the most brutal fashion. In a word, a strategy of counterpower only has any meaning in the perspective of dual power and its resolution, who will come out on top. The type of party envisioned by Bensaïd is not the caricature of paper sellers found at every protest or those locked in arcane debates that resemble the medieval theologians discussing with great fervor how many angels can dance on the head of the pin. Rather, this one begins with the belief that victory is actually possible. For if one accepts in advance that the enemy cannot be defeated, then you can never win. Without this perspective, Bensaïd says, we risk backsliding towards reformism and giving up our revolutionary vision. And he says, in the best case, of cases, this something else will be a resistance organization useful for day-to-day problems. More likely, though, renouncing the final goal will lead either to pseudo-realistic adaptations in the day-to-day struggle itself, or to an organization focused on the distant future, posing as the best fighter against potential bureaucratic degradations for lack of anything to propose for the present. Thus, without our eyes on the revolutionary goal and working patiently toward it, communists risk either giving up on the goal and sinking into practical politics, which is the old social democratic reformist era, or to remain so fixated on the communist horizon that we remain a sect aloof from the suffering and struggles of that the masses endure. This gap is to be bridged, he says, by developing a Leninist politics. Some may argue that a Leninist politics with its discipline and organization is foreign to dialectical voluntarism, as we discussed earlier. Yet Peter Howard argues to the contrary that it is one thing to dream that another world is possible. It is quite another to organize a practical political object, one that has a chance of winning the battles that confront it. That's the whole issue, how to get to that point. and the realization of the collective political will is to be found in a communist party, because the forces arrayed against us are powerful and united, while the working masses are often disunited and disorganized. An instrument needed to bring the masses together in the shape of the fist. Howard goes on, anyone involved in a popular struggle knows that if you are to continue to fight and to fight to win, then we need to maintain solidarity and unity to resist fragmentation and dispersal, to invent forms of discipline and organization, and to encourage means of leadership that are both responsive and decisive. A popular mobilization prevails when its sense of purpose is strong and its principles clear, and when it is prepared to take the steps necessary to apply them. So if we're serious about building the capacity of a communist party that can win, what do we have to do? For one, majority support is necessary from all the oppressed and exploited throughout society. As we saw, Bensaïd believes that the working class needs to be at the center of the revolutionary project, but that the struggle cannot be solely reduced to capital versus labor. Rather, taking up Gramsci's notion of hegemony and the united front, Bensaïd says workers need to have their own vision and to demonstrate that another society is possible. With the proletariat itself as the driving force behind that endeavor, this must be demonstrated to some degree before the seizure of power, lest this be a leap into the unknown, a half-hearted running jump, a smash and grab, or a push. So the notion of transitional demands and that of the united front are tools for winning over a majority. And this means a party that, through its deep immersion in the popular struggles, is also looking beyond them, as well as towards a wider goal. Concerning that Bensaïd views society and social classes as far more complex than vulgar Marxism, this is reflected in its vision of how the party needs to operate internally. For one, the party needs to be democratic and pluralist, not only to combat past abuses in socialist and communist movements, but to learn dialectically and teach their cadre. And he says, pluralism within the organization means that we do not hold any definite truths and that there is a constant exchange between the party we wish to build and the experiences of the mass movement. Since these experiences are quite diverse, this diversity may be reflected from time to time as currents within our own ranks. And this practice is reflected in the interaction of the party with the mass movement in which it is immersed. A dialectic of learning and teaching occurs whereby the party is able to record and synthesize the experiences of the masses in order to better participate in struggle. More importantly, a party that is flexible democratic, but also centralized, so it can correct a mistaken course in time to enable it to face a revolutionary situation with a correct line. And he says, with a party built on solid foundations, it is possible to correct tactical errors and even more fundamentally wrong orientations. The party is the mediation between theory and practice. Indeed, without that ability, true strategy is not able to develop. For the Prussian general, Moltke once said, no plan of operations extends with any certainty beyond the first contact with a main hostile force. That means you can plan to the best of your abilities beforehand, but reality will likely take you unaware. And if a revolutionary organization is unable to shift its strategy in time, then it will wind up shipwrecked on the shores of history. The example of Lenin is instructive here. Before 1917, Lenin believed that the Russian Revolution would undergo a prolonged bourgeois period, as outlined in his work, Two Tactics on Social Democracy. This analysis involved a particular alignment of class forces. However, reality intervened in 1917 with the downfall of the Tsar that placed on the agenda a socialist revolution. Lenin essentially threw out his old plans, writing the April Theses that it is necessary to transfer all power to the Soviets. While most of the Bolshevik Party initially remained bound to old formulas and schemes, Lenin was able to convince them to recognize the new opening of 1917 and change course. Since the Bolsheviks were already an open democratic party used to careful planning, they were able to change course as new possibilities appeared and to lead the revolution to victory. Bensaïd, following another contemporary, would say that we need to repeat Lenin's gesture in our day. Lenin stands for the compelling freedom to suspend the stale existing post-ideological coordinates. It simply means we're allowed to think again. Bensaïd does not fall into the trap of envisioning a party that refuses leadership of the struggle for fear of vanguardism. Rather, a party needs to build up a majority movement by becoming a pole of attraction to disparate forces and movements. A pole, he says, should be able at once to promote unity in a powerful way and fertilize this unity with revolutionary content. The key will be the questions and forces which arise from experiences and struggles. These will bring out the potential elements for a new revolutionary party. In every revolutionary movement, there is a pole of attraction for separate movements moving towards the same goal. In Cuba, there was the July 26 movement of Fidel Castro, which did not operate alone, but was in a larger constellation of forces. It was precisely the July 26 movement, though, which served as a pole and attracted these other movements by providing ideological and political leadership. And the ultimate goal to orient the myriad struggles of a communist party is the seizure of power. Considering that Bensaïd views the class struggle not as a linear process, but possessing their own ruptures, breaks, and speeds, which he captures in this poignant passage, revolutions have their own tempo marked by accelerations and slowing down. They also have their own geometry, with the straight lines broken in bifurcation and sudden turns. The party thus appears in a new light, becomes a strategic operator, a sort of gearbox and pointsman of the class struggle. As Walter Benjamin very closely recognized, the strategic time of politics is not the homogeneous and empty time of classical mechanics, but a broken time full of knots and wombs pregnant with events. When a revolution erupts, it will suspend the old way of doing things, making new openings possible, and a party needs to be ready for these sudden turns. Well, Mao certainly was not someone Bensaïd agreed with politically. An example from his career, I think, helps illustrate this. When the Japanese invaded China in 1937, the Communist Party formed an alliance with the Nationalists, whom they'd been at war with for more than 10 years. But the sharp turn was done by the Communists maintaining both their political independence from the Nationalists and their weapons. Furthermore, as the war dragged on, the Nationalists proved both unwilling and unable to fight the Japanese for fear of the Communists gaining advantage. Mao's forces were thus able to prove in practice that they were not only committed to fighting the Japanese, but in many cases age-old abuses and oppression that had afflicted China. When World War II ended, the Communist Party had gained immense prestige and popularity based both on their program and their struggles against the invader, while the national state was rotting and isolated. And 4 years later, the Communist Party managed to take power. And what happens afterwards is, of course, another story. A Communist Party must be able to face the sharp turns, breaks, and seize the opportunities which present themselves, for they can appear in unexpected corners. And due to the nature of history and struggle, which was composed of breaks and zigzags, a party needed to be, and he says, a strategizing party, a party that organizes struggles based on suggested goals, that can also organize and limit defeats by preparing a retreat when necessary. There are examples from Bensaïd's experience of Trotskyist and revolutionary organizations which did not learn this lesson and were either unable to develop a viable politics or limit defeats, such as the Argentine guerrillas and the Chilean movement of the revolutionary left. In the end, both those parties met with utter disaster. By contrast, the Bolsheviks under Lenin managed to prevent a premature attempt at power in July 1917, realizing that the time was unripe. And because the Bolsheviks learned those lessons, they were able to navigate the rocky waters of 1917 and strike when the time did prove right. Throughout this essay, we have used historical examples to make Benjamin's points. For while he believed that each situation was unique and the past shouldn't be mechanically repeated, Bensaïd never denied the importance of history for strategy in the party, and he says, you can't throw history at the door. You can throw history at the door, but it will kick over the traces and come back in through the window. But the historical dialectic of old and new is subtler than any binary or mechanical opposition between old and new, including in the methodological sense. Yes, let the new flourish. Do not give in to routine and habit. Stay open to surprise and astonishment. This is all useful advice. By what standard can we value the new if we lose all memory of the old? Thus, when formulating our strategies and plans for action today, learning from what worked and what went wrong, we need to study closely the lessons of the past. If communists reject one strategy or plan, we still need to know exactly what we are rejecting. And Bensaïd's embrace of dialectical voluntarism and strategy is based as much upon his reading of history along with his openness to the future. Bensaïd's insistence on the importance of history to the revolutionary project goes to the heart of his polemic with another communist philosopher in France named Alain Badiou. Badiou, who was a former Maoist, upholds a politics of fidelity to the event in opposition to the reigning tyranny of opinion that there are no emancipatory truths. According to Bensaïd, a truth is sparked by an event and spreads like a flame fanned by the by the breath of a subjective effort that remains forever incomplete. For truth is not a matter of theory, but is a practical question first and foremost. It is something that occurs, a point of excess, an eventual exception, a process from which something new emerges. And a political truth is the October Revolution, the storming of the Bastille, the slave revolt of Spartacus with its own faithful subjects, who we can name as Communist Party militants, the sans culottes, or the liberated slave, proclaiming the universal truth of equality. Yet Badiou, according to Bensaïd, believes that the emergence of a truth is something that happens out of the void and beyond history. And he says, what is exactly is an event, aleatory by nature, unpredictable. The event cannot be predicted outside a singular situation, nor even deduced from that situation without some unpredictable chance operation. So how do communists take advantage of an event? How do we develop strategy? How can we recognize the conditions in history that lead to an event? According to Bensaïd, Badiou remains silent on this score by refusing to venture into the dense thickets of real history, into the social and historical determination of events. Badiou's notion of the political tips over into a wholly imaginary dimension. This is a politics made tantamount to an act of levivation, reduced to a series of unconditional events and sequences whose exhaustion or end remain forever mysterious. Thus, for Bensaïd, Badiou's subject remains outside of history. The revolutionary subject is no longer seen as the working class in struggle proclaiming its own politics, which amounts to autonomous politics of the oppressed. And this divorce between event and history tends to render politics, if not unthinkable, then at least impractical. This means that Badiou's politics, according to Bensaïd, is a grand refusal, platonic gesture of a pure free decision that washes away a party capable of intervening and producing a collective will. Fidelity in Badiou's sense is the refusal to surrender or to submit that is unable to think on strategy or how to develop organizations. Bensaïd traces the problems of Badiou's understanding to Marx and history, to his inability to grasp the legacy of Stalin and Mao. And Badiou reproaches Badiou for being unable to envision a communist or Marxist politics outside of the Maoist tradition. And in fact, Badiou believes the old Marxist-Leninist party is now exhausted and believe revolutionary politics in the future will be post-party. While it could be justly argued that the alternative of Trotskyism that Bensaïd implies is not much more viable, but leaving that aside, what does Badiou offer as an alternative? The political practice of Badiou's own organization is done at a distance from the state, intervening in certain local struggles, but without a program and divorcing politics from economics, but in practice relying on the state. Yet the Badiou's organization are ultimately, according to Peter Halwart, who's written on this, a stoical affirmation of a worthy ideal or subjective principle, but it's divorced from any substantial relation to the material organization of the situation. By Bensaïd's standard, this shows the weaknesses in translating Badiou's ideas into political action. This is not the end of the polemic with Badiou, defeated at the hands of Bensaïd. Recently, Badiou has reaffirmed the need for a political organization that curiously resembles that of a communist party, though, using that name in his work, The Rebirth of History. And he says, a politics regards as eternal what the right has unearthed in the form of the existence of the inexistent, and which is the sole content of the rebirth of history. To do this, it is necessary that in light of the idea which abstractly unites militants, the organization retains traces within itself of what made for the creative power of the historical riot, contradiction, intensification, and localization. Classically, contraction, whereby a small minority is the genuine force of the whole riot, is guarded by strict rules of membership of the organization. A formal demarcation is created between those who are of it and those who are not, and which is powerful as the demarcation between a riot, between those who are there and those who stay at home. Intensification is preserved by militant activism, a life devoted to the demands of action, a subjectivity that is keener and more sensitive to circumstances than one which is reverted to routine existence. Localization will be guarded by firm rules of conquest of the sites where one is present. This site constitute the militant dimension of a particular type of organization, which was called the Communist Party for some decades in the 20th century, but which must doubtless speak a different name today. remains to be seen how Badiou's recent and cautious advocacy of political advocacy will impact his overall project. Something for perhaps another lecture, perhaps not. Is he breaking with the limitations of his own organizational form and post party, and returning or repeating a Leninist gesture that Bensaïd would wink at and approve? Maybe, maybe not. But it would appear that Bensaïd's assessment of Badiou's philosophy as rendering revolutionary politics impossible should not be taken to be the final word. Daniel Bensaïd's thought and practice was directed toward thinking about through how to maintain revolutionary fidelity, stressing organization, strategy, and the importance of history. Yet he always insisted, following both Benjamin and Blanqui, that history remained radically open with no certainty of victory. So in that sense, we present Bensaïd here not as a new messiah who offered us the correct path to triumph. That would be betrayal of what he stood for. Rather, Bensaïd remained committed to the revolutionary cause when others fell away, and he was still envisioning how to do the impossible, others had surrendered to being realistic. That, more than anything else, justifies the importance of Daniel Bensaïd, and that we ignore him at our peril. So, before we start with questions or anything, thank you all for coming. I know it's a small crowd. And the Center for Marxist Education is kept in business by comrades like you. We have no corporate sponsors. Sorry, I wanted to do a play on the PBS one instead. if you're not signed up for the email list, feel free. Like us on Facebook, events, I'm just going to pass it around. This one, I should tell you, I wrote this. This was the last one, thankfully, I wrote back in February when I was snowed in, like everyone else. So now I've done all the snowed in lectures. And I did all the summer ones, actually, already. But I know it kind of got a little abstract, and I was referencing a bunch of debates within French philosophy, but I mean, I think some of that was accessible.
Seems to be a continuity from just talking and one on Maria.
I couldn't hear you. Yes, yeah, no, there definitely is. I mean, you'll actually probably notice that, like, the Benjamin talk is like a continuation of parts of this, which is also a continuation of Gramsci and Lukács. But yeah, some of the similar themes, because I'm probably more attracted to that type of politics than, say, Poulantzas or Althusser overall, even if I wouldn't dismiss everything Althusser said. But feel free to ask questions, comments, polemics, what have you. Yeah, go ahead.
I'm just curious, talk at all about international organization?
Well, yes, actually. He was part of, I don't know what name it goes by now, but it was then called the United Secretariat of the Fourth International. And he actually had an essay, I don't think I referenced it in this, but it was written around 1980. And he's talking about how the left responded to the 60s. And he's more talking about the Trotskyist left than anything, but one of his points he stresses, like, we need international organization. So that's a big point. And I don't want to get too much into what's going on in France now, but I think, first of all, he was actually born in Algeria to Jewish parents. Which probably gets into another theme why some of these people may carry over, but... So his internationalism was sprung early, like his family was very Republican, in the small R French sense. And, you know, he started again with solidarity with the Algerian Revolution, and later would be solidarity with Vietnam and other struggles. So, I mean, I think compared to many segments of the French left, I mean, I think he was a very good example of internationalism in practice. Like, he went down to Argentina at one point. He went to Brazil. He went to a lot of these places. And, you know, his organization, I can't speak to current positions, but I think they weathered a lot of these storms better than a lot of others. That's not to say that they were perfect, but I mean...
Is that the LCR?
The LCR, yeah.
They are now,
I always sometimes get this wrong, the New Anti-Capitalist Party. They changed their name. There was an interview published with one of their leaders on Jacobin that I haven't read yet. And I mean, they had some good responses, in my view, to the whole what's going on in France right now. Like, they came out like, you know, your war are dead. You know, so that they, you know, they were standing against, like, a lot of the police emergencies and, you know, a lot of that, and Islamophobia, which I think is good on their part. And someone feel free to correct me if I'm wrong, but that's, like, me, like, at a distance looking at this. Maybe I'm wrong and they suck. Sure.
Well, that's a real debate going on. I don't have a hard line in particular on the anti-capitalist party. It's sort of a maneuver to draw in a broader layer of people in the electoral arena. I imagine there's a certain amount of, say, organizational independence, but I'm not aware of that. In this anti-capitalist party, there is a core of LCR people, but it doesn't have the kind of Leninist norms that you would have in a Leninist party. And, you know, I think that there are things to be said for that, to work with a broader layer of people toward a united goal.
I mean, yeah. I mean, first of all, the NPA, which is what it is now, does not define itself as Trotskyist, and I don't think it defines itself as Leninist. Again, feel free to correct me on that.
No, you're right.
And it is a broad left party. It's also, as is so often on the left, it's not the only broad left party in France. There's something called the Left Front, which that actually, I believe, has more CP involved, or PCF, you know, the French part, the Communist Party. The NPA, I don't think, has really succeeded in their goal of becoming this new broad, like, left of the Socialist Party in France. It's still there, but it isn't the French Syriza or something like that. It's relatively small by French standards. It's still larger than most of the ones here, but again, French standards are slightly different here than here. Feel free. I mean,
for becoming the next Syriza, the Socialist Party would probably collapse. Probably the PCF as well.
I want the Socialist Party to collapse so bad. You freaking hate the French Socialist Party. With, like, when you have, like, freaking people, like, who were head of the IMF in the Socialist Party.
Mm-hmm.
When you support World War One,
yeah,
in Algeria. Okay. But, yeah. I just
nuclear testing in the Pacific.
I'm also not a big fan of the French Communist Party. That's another story. Feel free, anything, like, some of this, you know, goes into, like, dense theoretical stuff, which hopefully was understandable, but if you want to touch on stuff, go ahead. Doing stuff I didn't cover should have covered.
Well, last talk in the tech, we mentioned that he was influenced by Sorel.
Mm-hmm.
Sorel had actually been influenced by different currents, including American pragmatism, especially William James, which he wrote a book on. And what he got, I think, from James was the idea of indeterminism.
Yeah, actually, in Bensaïd's essay on Blanqui, which he authors with another Trotskyist, he does reference as part of the repressed left Sorel, actually. A lot of Bensaïd is not translated into English. I mean, I was mostly going on English sources. Since I wasn't going to do some huge, like, this is the correct line, I figured that it's okay. But he does reference Sorel as part of, like, this repressed left. And he seems to be drawing upon, like you said, this kind of indeterminism. He recognizes, like, some of the whack stuff in Sorel, but he does explicitly reference it. I don't know about pragmatism specifically, though, but... And yes, I probably should do Sidney Hook, kind of. I know you really want me to do that, and I might do that.
Sidney Hook, communist, and Indian communist.
I might just do communist, because actually, the stuff's good. But that's another...
Well,
he was
a communist.
Yeah, I know.
And
then
he became a staunch...
That's another story. If anyone's got stuff... Sure, John.
I think that the stuff you outlined there, I thought it was very, a lot clearer than what we hear from a lot of the left historically about what to do and how to do it. I think a lot of the lessons that are put forward in your talk today were largely lost on the U.S. left in this country over the last, say, 40, 45 years. That being able to adapt to new situations, being able to keep the focus on politics and develop a strategy that adapts to the times led to, that inability led to largely the destruction of the left in this country. A lot of people will blame COINTELPRO, they will blame various things, whereas I blame the left. They screwed it up, and I watched it year after year after decade, with dogmas. Your struggle has to be organized in the unions, and the other stuff on the outside isn't all that important, really. Or from the other end, the unions are backward, and why bother with them?
Sure.
Kind of approach, and the sectarianism of front groupism, which dominates so much of the left in this country, had its origins, way back at least 45, 50 years, and that's a bankrupt strategy, as opposed to the United Front. I think the United Front, as conceived in the 30s, was with mass organizations forming these fronts. Well, you didn't have that in the United States, and other forms of the United Front were developed here, which essentially, they were rejected. The ones that worked, like by, I would say, the early 80s, were rejected, and then we're in this historical abyss that's, beginning to reorient and redevelop in this country today.
Yeah, I want to respond to a number of points you made. Although I don't any longer consider myself a Trotskyist, I don't consider myself an anti-Trotskyist by any means. I mean, I think there's a lot of positive lessons to draw out of this, about that particular, tradition of the left. And I think Bensaïd, first of all, like, when I read his stuff, it's like very fresh and lively. That may be his translators too, but it's still very fresh and lively writings. It's not, it's not like Frankfurt School or postmodern, what have you, which, that stuff can just be gobbledygook. I just find it's like very refreshing to read it. And he was dealing with some of what you're describing, although, again, in a more European context, like a lot of the mass movements that came out of, say, the French left after 1968, they foundered by this late 70s or 80s. Like, a lot of those Maoists, they became like staunch anti-communists.
Yep.
They became like parts of these new philosophers. Some, again, Badu being one, tried to maintain some kind of fidelity to it. There were Trotskyists too who entered the Socialist Party, and they sold out. And we could of course go on about
the Socialist Prime Minister.
Yeah.
Was famously a next president.
That's right. Yeah, Lionel Jospin.
Jospin.
And and so it's not like one tradition is exempt from experiencing that. And yesterday, again, I mentioned this at the beginning of the talk, I filmed yesterday a talk on the RCP yesterday. In a Maoist context in the U.S., they face limitations. Yes, they face police repression, but they made choices too.
That's right.
And they screwed up.
They all did.
And it's like, Bensaïd, and this is like part of the appeal, he was trying to think through this moment, like you said, you're in the abyss of history. How do you think through that? What do you do now? And I'm not going to repeat everything I said, but I think like trying to think through that is important, because it's like, I remember when I was younger, it's like, okay, it's like you'd ask yourself, like, oh, what would I do in 1917 or 1949? It's like, that seems very clear, but what do you do when it's not 1917? Like, how do you think through that? How do you deal with that? And I think the questions he raised, we can, if you disagree with the answers, that's fine, that's your business. But it's like, I think he asked a lot of important questions about, okay, like, it's like, if things are not guaranteed, then why are we doing this? It's like, so he's rejecting a lot of this old determinism, this economism that comes out of various forms of Marxism, including found in some veins of Trotskyism and Maoism as well. And I find that valuable, trying to think through it, because it's one thing to say, oh, there are ebbs and flows of struggle. It's another thing to live through ebbs and flows and struggles.
Yeah. You're damn straight.
So, and I suspect most people here have lived through them.
I can heap abuse on the RC.
Sure. And they deserve a lot of it.
I can heap abuse on every single group. I mean, even the one I belong to. I mean, it's just like mistake after mistake after mistake. The only thing I can say is that in my experience, I tried to provide an alternative while it was unfolding, you know, and that involves factional warfare, you know, and not always being in favor, you know, or looked upon in a favorable light, you know, and whether it's Occupy Wall Street or whatever, you know, big freaking errors being made, you know, right in front of our eyes.
And sometimes, and this is something, this comes out of T.S. Eliot, of all people, who said there are times like the only way to maintain fidelity to a religion, he's using that analogy, is to either become sometimes with a religion, the only thing to do is to become either a heretic or a non-believer,
yep.
Or to have a sectarian split. Because there are times like these old moribund institutions, do you stick with it? You know, and just become part of nothing,
yep.
Or you become an unbeliever and, you know, do what so many do, or you split from it and try to maintain some fidelity, to try and get your feet back on the ground. I'm not quite sure I have all the answers, but I do like these questions. If anyone has other questions, comments, concerns, feel free. No? Going once? Going twice?
Thanks, Doug.
Thanks, Doug.